trust that the peace that you need from Christ will be with you today. Thank you for doing that. Thank you. Yeah, I know she would have wanted you to be standing up here and singing and signing as you were. That's a great gift to her and to us as well. So thank you for that. Would you all be in prayer for our trees over here, by the way? I'm not sure. Not sure what's going on after service. I'm going to get back there, and there's probably a loose connection in there somewhere. So anyways, yeah. And maybe in the time that I'm standing up here preaching, something will come back together, and it'll just come on. And if it does, it'll be a Christmas miracle. So we're on the last week of our Advent message series, O Come All You Unfaithful. And so today we come to the last message on this fourth Sunday of Advent, the Sunday of Love. And we are going to read from Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 10 this morning. I'll give you a moment to turn there. And as you're turning there, again, a reminder about our Christmas Eve services tonight at 5 and 11. And there may have been a few people that came in after I had mentioned that this morning. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 10, and this is a scripture that is very familiar to most of us, I assume. Going back to Sunday school days, just giving myself a moment to pick up the scripture unless someone's got a Bible ready for me right now. Pastor Cindy, as always, you're the best. It's heavy. It is heavy. I will give it back to you when I'm done. There we go, big letters. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 10. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden?" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but did God say you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it or you will die?" "You will not certainly die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat from it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some and ate it. She also gave some to her husband, who was with her, and he ate it as well. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man, and he said, "Where are you?" He answered, "I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid." The word of God for the people of God. Thank you, Pastor Cindy. So during Bible college days, Becca lived, her family lived out in northwest Kansas in a town called Oberlin, Kansas. So about four-hour drive from Manhattan, where we were both going to Bible college. And during one such break, I went out to visit Becca and Oberlin. And on the way back from Oberlin to Manhattan, I was going through a town called Phillipsburg, still in northwest Kansas. Has anyone driven through Phillipsburg on Highway 36? Now, most of the time when I drove through these small little Kansas towns on Highway 36, I could tell you where there would be the town deputy, a town marshal, running radar. I knew when you get into those towns and the speed limit decreases, you better just go ahead and save yourself the time and the money and just decrease your speed, because they will be waiting for you if you go speeding into their town. So one particular drive on the way back to Manhattan from Oberlin, I don't know if I was distracted with the radio or lost in my thoughts, but I had this sinking feeling in the pit of my stomach when I saw flashing lights in my mirrors, and I knew just immediately what had happened. And I looked down at my thermometer, speedometer, thank you, and got pulled over for speeding. I was doing a 45 and a 30, and was given a ticket, went back home, went into my room at the apartment I was living in, and put the ticket on my desk. Over the course of 30 days, I was supposed to pay the ticket over the course of 30 days, and some books sat on top of there, and some papers, and a few other things, and of course, I was a little irresponsible as a young college student, and just kind of, the ticket was out of sight, out of mind, and about 2 or 3 months later, I was driving back to see Becca in Oberlin, and I pull into the town of Phillipsburg, Kansas, and again, that sinking feeling in the pit of my stomach, I was like, I got a ticket here a few months ago, I was supposed to pay that ticket, and in my mind, I knew where that ticket was sitting at, on my desk, in my room, covered up by all sorts of other things. And so on the way, really through Phillipsburg that first time, I did about 15 and a 30, and a cold sweat all the way through town, I made it through town. On the way back, I just went down south and hit I-70 and came east. I got to my room immediately, found the ticket, I called the clerk, I just vehemently apologized, and the clerk was so kind, she was so nice. And she said, well, and she encouraged me, said, you probably need to pay that as soon as possible. But she was really kind. And so, today's invitation, the message today is this invitation to come, guilty and hiding ones, there is no need to run. Your God, see what your God has done. Come, all you who are guilty and hiding, feeling some sort of condemnation, feeling some kind of guilt for something that you've done. Now, as humans, we belong to a long line of people, going back generations, that when we as humans feel guilt, most of the time our natural inclination is to run and hide. Now, I don't know what age Adam and Eve were in the story in Genesis 3, but the story reads very similar to probably some of your own childhood experiences. Think back to growing up in the home that you did. And doing things that you knew that you weren't supposed to do, knowing that you were going to get caught. But I wonder if maybe you have a hiding story from childhood. I wonder if you have a hiding story maybe in your teenage years, hiding something from your parents, from a teacher. Maybe you have a hiding story at some point in your grown adult life. Now, I would imagine there's probably no one in this room today who can say that every time you sinned, every time you erred, every time you made a mistake, that you immediately took accountability, you immediately apologized, and immediately accepted the consequences for your actions. Is there anyone in here that could say the opposite is true for me? All right. Very good. So everyone's truthful in here today. That's perfect. Thank you so much. We've all realized our spiritual nakedness in the aftermath of our rebellion and sin. We've all sought to cover up things, to sweep things under the rug, and to hope that our wrongs go unnoticed and hopefully forgotten with the passage of time. Now, can we blame Adam and Eve for hiding? If you were told, do not do this or you will die, you think that's a pretty solid warning? I don't know if your parents told you, if you eat the cookie from the cookie jar, you will die. I don't know if I would. I mean, I know there's some people in here that would have tested that theory, I have no doubt. Probably a good chunk of us would maybe take them at their word, depending on how old you were and how naive you were. So that's a foreboding warning. If you eat this, you will die. And so I'll be honest, I would have hid, just like Adam and Eve. When it says that they sewed fig leaves to cover up their nakedness, I assume and I imagine that it wasn't just a few leaves like we see in the picture, in the historical pictures where they're just covering up a few parts of their body, but I think maybe covering up with leaves is more like, anyone worn a ghillie suit before, been out hunting, and you kind of want to camouflage yourself? I would imagine that it wasn't just to cover up just a few parts, but that they were actually covering up to hide from God. We could say this was the first instance humanity when camouflage came about. This is when camouflage was invented in Genesis chapter 3. Now, can't you imagine the scenario of Eve and Adam hiding under their leaves, hiding from God? They know they're in trouble. Eve says to Adam, "Why do you have to breathe so loud? Why is your breathing so annoying? If God finds us, it's your fault." Anyone? No, I'm not going to ask. Okay. Hiding makes sense in this story if being found by God was a horrible and dreadful thing. If being found by God in this instance was a terrible thing, then Adam and Eve had every right to hide themselves in the garden. But what we see as we read Scripture from Genesis to Revelation is that God is gracious. And God is kind towards those who choose to come into the light with their faults, with their brokenness, with their sin, instead of remaining in our dark hiding places. Adam and Eve, they feared death. They feared the consequences of their sin. But if we can learn anything from this story, from Genesis 3, is that even though there are consequences, yes, consequences are just baked into the system of our sin. When we sin, we sow seeds of sin into this world and in our lives. Consequences are just going to be there, and it's not because God wants to zap you and strike you down. It's just the fruit of the seeds that we sown. But even in the midst of the consequences of our sin, beloved, hear this. God's heart is for restoration, not for retribution. So if you're hiding from God in fear of retribution, understand God's heart for all people, for all sinners, everyone here is restoration, not retribution. In fact, God's retribution is intended for Satan. It's not intended for you. And thus, God says to Adam and Eve in the garden in chapter 3 that despite their failures, that he was going to cause an offspring to come from the seed of woman who would crush the head of the serpent who sunk his poisonous fangs into humanity. I love the picture on the screen of there's Eve with her shame covered up. And at the bottom by her feet is the serpent, the snake that bit into her, the poisonous sickness of sin. And the story of redemption with Mary standing there, consoling her, pregnant with child, with the offspring, Jesus, the God-man, Jesus Christ, who would come to crush the head of the serpent once and for all, to reveal the heart of our Heavenly Father towards us in the midst of our guilt and hiding. And so the question is, what is the heart of God towards the guilty and hiding? Jesus clues us into the very thing, into the very heart of God towards those who are sinners in the parable of the prodigal son. Now, the parable of the prodigal son is one that we know so well in this place. In fact, I could probably have a seat and have a good number of you come up here and just from memory tell everyone what the story of the prodigal son is all about. But I think we know this story so well, we have such a head knowledge of the story of the prodigal son that the truth of it rarely ever actually gets to our heart. And why do I say that? Well, I think it's because we still have this view and this image of God as a father that is nothing like the father that we see in the parable of the prodigal son. We have this image of God as this old, angry, bearded man in the sky who doesn't want kids playing on his lawn. He's the one that says, "Hey, get off my lawn, you. I just put down seed or fertilizer on my lawn." Or we have this image of God as maybe that town deputy, right? That town marshal who's just waiting for you to come strolling through his town because he wants to put you in the prison cell because you forgot to pay your speeding ticket. Side note, Please pay your speeding tickets. Actually, just don't speed at all, and then you don't have to worry about getting a speeding ticket, right? So some of you are from a generation where you had to go outside and you had to pick a switch. How many of you had to pick a switch? Question for you. Would you get kind of the small, sort of skinny ones that acted more like a whip, or would you get more of the thicker, like, stick? I don't know, which one hurt the worst? How many of you in this place got paddled in school growing up? Let's see your hands. How many got paddled? Yep, as I suspected. Yep, I'm seeing some familiar faces. My brothers and I got whooped with the belt on the rear, and if we lied, my dad would get that hand soap. He'd put it on his hand and have a stick out our tongue, then he would just rub that hand soap all over. I could still taste it in my mouth as I talk about it. Some of you spent a good chunk of time sitting in the corner, and it shows. Some of you spent a good chunk of time being grounded from going out and playing with friends, riding your bicycles, listening to the radio. Oh, how horrible that would have been to be grounded from listening to the radio. Watching TV, using your computer or tablet. And so you know that what we do is we take these things that happen to us as kids, from adults, from grandparents, these consequences that came to us because of our sin, and we take the scowl from maybe the worst person that we can think of, and we attach it to God the Father. I'm confident that there are some people in here today whose only thought of God at this moment is how disappointed he is in you. Your mental image of God is one with a stern, angry look, and perhaps a pointing finger. You live every day crippled with guilt from something in your past. Maybe it's something in your present. Maybe it's a current daily struggle. And your biggest fear is stepping out from the darkness and into the light. It's your biggest fear because there's shame, there's condemnation, and it's a huge weight upon your soul even today. One of my favorite things to do when we go to restaurants, when there are those low-hanging lights over the table that you can kind of move them around, is I'll shine them in the face of whoever's there, and I'll say, "Where were you on the night of?" Fill in the blank. Try that sometime. Next time you're at a restaurant, as long as they're on those flexible, I mean, if it's like on a metal pole, don't try to do that, but what if instead of a blinding spotlight trying to find you in your sin, what if God's light that he wants you to step into were more like, imagine the prodigal son's father. The son has been away for a long time. The father keeps watch day and night. And at night, he's hoping that at some point the son is going to come in to the house, and so he lights a fire in the fireplace that puts off a glow in the distance in the hopes that when the son is on the way home, he comes home and he sees this glowing hearth waiting for him. What if the light that God is calling for you to step into isn't a blinding light in your face, but it's the glow of his hearth, inviting you to come in close, to come home, to warm up, to be fed? What if God's searching light were less of a flashlight trying to catch you in the act, and more of a torch light leading the way for a search party, that all they care about is for your well-being and to bring you back? What if God's light that he's calling you to step into were more like that? In Luke 15, Jesus depicts God as this father whose eyes are always scanning the horizon, always looking out, waiting for his son, his daughter to come back to him. And at the first sight of his child on the horizon, the father runs to greet the prodigal with hugs and kisses and a greeting and a welcome, throwing a lavish party. What if that was the mental image of God for those who are in shame, to think of God as your father who wants to restore you and bring you back? Jesus also depicts God the Father in Luke 15 as this shepherd who has one lost sheep. And in order to find that sheep, he leaves the 99 safe in their pen, and he goes out until that one sheep is found. And when that one sheep is found, it's not found for slaughter, it's found for restoration, bringing back into the fold. In Luke 15, Jesus also mentions God the Father as one who's this woman who lost a coin in the house. And she turns everything over, looking night and day for this coin until the coin was found, because it was so precious to her. How many of you probably have like a penny sitting in a couch at your house right now? And how many of you have like, I'm missing one penny somewhere? I know there's one person in here. Like, you miss one penny and you're going on a search. But for the most part, you know, like, think about that. One coin, one measly coin is missing from the collection. And God is the Father who says, that coin is valuable to me. And I'm going to look and I'm going to search until that coin is found. Beloved, if you are hiding with guilt today, understand that your Heavenly Father is arms wide open. He loves you. He's not disappointed with you. He wants you to learn a lesson, but he wants you to come home. If you are hiding under the weight of guilt, hear the good news here from Hebrews 10:19-23. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter into the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, with full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water, let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, for he who promised is faithful. You don't have to live with guilt and condemnation and shame. As you step into the light, because of the blood of Jesus, your guilty conscience can be cleansed. You don't have to carry that weight. I love the words from 1 John 1:9. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and will purify us from all unrighteousness. If we confess our sins, if we step into the light, God is faithful and just to forgive us of all of our sins, every single one, to purify us of every unrighteousness that we hold on to and that we let drag us down. I want to close this message with a scene from The Chosen, episode 1, season 1. This was the scene that I was very skeptical about this, watching this series, The Chosen, until I saw this particular scene, episode 1, season 1. And it's a scene where Mary of Magdala, Mary Magdalene as we call her, in this particular episode, they're using biblical sources, but also kind of filling in the blanks a little bit about who Mary might have been, knowing her to have been a prostitute and to be one who probably took substance abuse from time to time. In this particular episode, they portray Mary as not going by her name because of shame, because she was wanting to hide from who she was and where she was from. She, in this episode, is known as Lilith. And just setting up the scene for you, Lilith is about to walk into a a tavern of sorts, a first century tavern. And I want you, in thinking about the heart of God for those who have guilt, who are ashamed, who are hiding, think about this scene and think about the heart of God revealed through Jesus in this scene. If we can get the lights and if we could play this video.
Not now.
Fine. She smells anyway.
I don't know what else I can do to help you.
Give me that. Lots of it.
That's not going to solve your problems. It's meant to distract from
them. No more preaching. Just give it to me.
Lilith, please listen to what I'm
saying. Leave.
That's not for you.
Don't touch me. Oh.
Lily, are you okay?
I have to go. Leave me alone. Leave me alone.
Mary. Mary of Magdala.
Who are you? How do you know my name?
Thus says the Lord who created you. And he who formed you. Fear not. For I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine.
How is that for a picture of God? I think you said it at communion time. He knows your name. He's got the number of hairs counted on your head. He's got your address. He was there the day that you were born. He knows when you're going to take your last breath. And he's there every single day in between, every second, never leaves you or forsakes you. And so, come, guilty and hiding ones, there is no need to run. See what your God has done. Let us pray. Lord, I know you're tugging on the heart of somebody today. Or maybe somebody's. You're tugging on my heart. Because I know I've often viewed you as a God who just was looking to catch me and wanting to punish me, was always never happy enough, because I'm never good enough. And so, Lord, for those who need to hear their Father's voice, their Creator's voice, speak to them today, that they would know that they were made for more, that you love them, that you want them to step into the light where Satan has no power, where sin has no power. Lord, help us to respond rightly today. I'm just going to ask your Holy Spirit to do the work that needs to be done. In Jesus' mighty and precious name.